This is an update in my continuing coverage of the intriguing star system called Trappist-1 that includes no less than 7 Earth-like rocky planets. See my first video on that on this channel for the backstory. In the few days since NASA's press conference, a clearer picture is emerging on just how bizarre yet familiar this star system is. There seems to be a high likelihood for liquid water existing on 2 of these worlds, and in fact could exist on all 7 if the atmospheric conditions of some of those worlds allow it. But there is actually a very specific reason why scientists think this is likely. When planets form out of the disks of debris that often surround young stars, the materials in the disk are not uniformly distributed. You can infer just where a planet originally formed by its composition. In early solar systems, planets tend to migrate until they ultimately settle into stable orbits. The current models for TRAPPIST-1 indicate that the planets of the system formed relatively far out from the star and eventually migrated inward. This would mean that they formed in an area of the disk that was rich in water ice. Warm water ice up, and you have liquid water. Where you have liquid water, you have the potential for life. Now, one point against TRAPPIST-1's planets developing life is their proximity to the star. They are really close, and when you are close to a star, you are subject to some serious radiation. One type of radiation that's unfriendly towards life is ultraviolet. Here on Earth, we are protected from the sun's UV radiation by the ozone layer. A similar ozone layer may protect one or more of the worlds at TRAPPIST-1. Only further study will tell. Another issue is the presence of a strong magnetic field to deflect radiation. These planets would need that to support life, but as with Earth, it has a strong magnetic field, so they may too. Again, further study here is needed. But in one area, the new planets are favored for life. Life here is linked to tidal pools early in Earth's history where the magic of organic chemistry could be worked that eventually leads to life. For life to develop, at least according to current thinking, you need tidal pools. Tidal pools need tides. Tides require a moon. Now at first glance, the mechanics of the TRAPPIST planetary system seems to disfavor moons. These planets pass very close to each other and affect each other with their gravity and probably would have tossed any moons out of the area pretty quickly. But that's also the saving grace. They pass so close that the planets themselves would create tidal effects on any water present in the system. So here we have a case where the circumstances allow for tides without moons. So let's say, hypothetically, that on one of the planets, microbial life has developed. The interesting thing here is that if it has, then at some point it is likely that life will arise on any of the other planets in the system that allow for it. The reason for this is panspermia. This is a process where impacts by asteroids can blow debris off one world where it would wander space for a bit and then land on another. It is possible for dormant microbial life to survive the journey, and in fact, it's possible that we've seen this firsthand, though the subject is more hotly debated than is commonly known. During the Apollo 12 mission to the Moon, astronauts retrieved the main camera from the Surveyor 3 mission that had been sitting on the Moon for 3 years. When they got it back to Earth, they found living bacteria between the lenses that appeared to have survived the harsh conditions of the Moon. Now, this has been widely criticized because there was apparently plenty of opportunity for contamination, but it still seems rather odd that the handful of bacteria all happened to be the same species and when cultured, behaved as though they had been dormant. The truth will likely never be known since the cameras are not now in a sterile environment. This sort of thing could easily occur with rocks, and might in fact have happened in our own solar system. One existing theory is that life in our solar system actually originated on Mars and was deposited on this planet by a meteorite. This theory is attractive because at the time that life arose on Earth, the environment here was not that great for the formation of life. Mars had once been a more hospitable place for life than Earth in this solar system. Given the very close proximity of the planets of TRAPPIST-1, these planets would pass by each other and look even larger in the sky than our moon does. It seems likely that materials get exchanged, or did in the past, due to impacts. As a result, life may have hitched a ride and populated more than just one world in this solar system. Only time will tell if these worlds at TRAPPIST-1 hold the potential for life, or are more likely to be sterile worlds. After all, 3 planets also lie within our sun's zone of habitability, and any alien culture out there studying us probably initially wondered if life could exist on all 3. But as they study the atmospheres of our planets, they would quickly see that the closest of the 3, Venus, is unsuitable for most straightforward kinds of life, and they would see that Mars is too small to hold the necessary atmosphere for much other than underground microbes. But then they would see our blue jewel and the oxygen life creates in its atmosphere, and then they would know. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently on the cusp of releasing a new book. It's called Supermind and explores the implications of the universe being a computer simulation set amongst a love story gone horribly wrong. And be sure to check out my other books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.